Welcome back to Scania at IAA. We are about to address a very important topic that affects all of us. And this topic is climate change. And we know that we have to take a joint effort and we need to take immediate action together. But let's take a closer look at how Scania is working together with partners and stakeholders to make the difference in the transport value chain. And by that, I would like to hand over to my colleague, Jenny Cato, from the Scania studio.
A warm welcome to all of you here at the Scania studio at IAA in Hanover. This panel is about sustainable partnerships and how we can work together in the transport value chain in order to obtain our respective climate targets. And therefore, we have invited representatives from our distinguished partnership, the Pathways Coalition, because we are literally part of our each other's value chains. And therefore, we need to work together in order to achieve, especially the Scope 3 targets that we have. The Scope 3 targets are typically the indirect emissions that the company can't control themselves. But since we are part of our respective value chains, what is Scope 3 for us could be the Scope 1 for you. So that is what we're going to discuss today. And for example, Scania, we are dependent on our customers, the transport companies, to buy our low emission or zero emission vehicles. And they, in their turn, are dependent on the transport buyers to demand zero emission transports. So with me today, I'm super happy to have Dinky Lin, Lead Sales Manager IoT from Ericsson. A warm welcome, Dinky.
Oh, thank you.
Peter Andersson, Business Manager E-Mobility, Heavy Transport at E.ON. And Marcus Milder, CEO of E-Mobility at Siemens E-Mobility. Thank you so much. So first of all, I turn to you, Peter. Can you elaborate a little bit on the Pathways Coalition and that partnership?
Sure. I think we were a lot of actors in the beginning of the market, wondering what will electrification mean for us. And quite soon we realized actually that it is not just about switching from one fuel to another. It will mean something completely different, a new value chain. And on top of that, actually it was a Scania study who showed that electrification wasn't just possible, it was a really good idea also. And that's when Pathway formed between E.ON, Scania, Siemens and H&M actually. And along the way, we realized that we have to cover more parts of the value chain, and that's why Ericsson and then PostNord also joined. And I think we have a foundation to really understand the new value chain from a different kind, or all different perspectives to understand what will be demanded for us to make this happen in reality also.
Great. So I think many of us are familiar with the E.ON brand. We know that you're a huge energy utility, grid company, but also that you provide charging and energy solutions, as well as electricity distribution. But what is your most important contribution in this transformation of the transport ecosystem and value chain?
Yeah, as you say, Jenny, we have twofold. We have two large business areas. One of course, is the grid part of our business, and the grid will be an enabler, a necessary enabler to make this happen. Electrification will, of course, demand a lot of energy, but also capacity to be able for us to provide energy when it's needed, actually. So that's one part that we are working really hard on. The other one is, of course, providing the market with energy and charging solution, working in partnership together with, for example, transport or transport buyer or actors like you at Scania, to really create the best suitable solution for each and every operation, actually. So that's we cover a lot of the energy value chain, you could say.
Yeah. So as a grid company, of course, you have an important role to play with providing electricity for the charging infrastructure. But what would you say your challenges are in regards to what you need from the companies building the charging infrastructure? What would you like them to how to cooperate with you?
We would appreciate if you start the project from in an early stage together with us. I think there are a lot of things that it's either really easy to start focusing as a customer on the most obvious things, but one simple thing is you need a grid connection, and it could take some time to get those available. So involve us in early stage, I would say.
Great. So now I turn to you, Marcus. We know that Siemens is a well-known technology company providing solutions for industry, for infrastructure, transport, and also healthcare. But what would you say is Siemens' most important role in the transition of the transport value chain and your contribution to this?
We have a complete portfolio of charging infrastructure. So coming from AC chargers for more residential, but also for depot applications, to fast chargers, DC fast charging, on the route, but also for depot or trucks or fleets, but then also the whole service concept around and software to enable these chargers and make the operation of the chargers more fluent for our customer. That said, this is an integral part of our portfolio, and we were coming from two sides to that. So on the one side, we're pretty much in the electrification of grids. We're providing hardware and software to build up electrical grids. But then we're also coming from the building operation, where you have infrastructures where chargers are integrated, where chargers play an important role in a depot, but also in an industrial park, etc. And these both sides, we want to deliver to connect it to a complete value chain. So the grid, the infrastructure, and then the charging infrastructure as a main element to that. And there was one thing you were mentioning just right away. We're also going into wireless charging, which is a little bit inductive instead of conductive. So that is also an area which we are pushing, and which will be also an area which is for the convenience of the operators, for the convenience of the drivers. And then we're also going for the more heavier trucks into autonomous charging. So for example, if you have an autonomous driving truck, doesn't make sense that somebody has to plug the cable in. So we're also offering now, we're investigating, putting a lot of research into these areas.
It's very interesting to hear about all of these technologies that you're deploying, but also you have your own transport needs as a transport buyer.
Yeah.
And how do you see your role in that? What do you need from your transport companies?
Yeah, look, what we need, on the one side, we have also our CO2 targets or CO2 reduction targets to become CO2 neutral in the future. And we're also applying them to the complete supply chain we're having. So we as a company, I guess we have over 200 manufacturing sites around the world, probably some 65,000 suppliers. And these are the companies we are also integrating in our targets. And we encourage a lot our suppliers, transportation companies, not only to sign in into our CO2 reduction targets, but in our overall sustainability targets.
So now I turn to you, Dinky, at Ericsson, one of the world's leading ICT companies.
Yes.
And I mean, for us, it might be evident, but for the audience, where do you see your role in the transport value chain?
Right. It's a very good question, by the way. When we talk about transport value chain, I would say this involves quite many different, you know, stakeholders from different like backgrounds or areas. And then those stakeholders, or you can say the people, would include people coming from, let's say, the transport infrastructure, the energy infrastructure, and also the digital infrastructure. And where we Ericsson sits, obviously, is the digital infrastructure. So now I would like to talk about like the end-to-end multimodal flow of goods from a manufacturer's production site via, you know, a number of transportation hubs or docks and consolidation sites, all right, all the way to the receiving part or consignee at a, for example, like at a private premise. During the whole flow, as you can imagine, this would relate to, you know, all the stakeholders and also, you know, many different types of assets, right? This is what I want to talk about. You know, all these multiple types of assets would include like pallets, containers, trailers, vehicles, and even like road or rail side equipment. And what we Ericsson really do is to enhance and provide the connectivities, put it this way, to connect assets with the site and also with the stakeholders, you know, in order to provide like better, let's say better operational efficiency and also to improve the sustainability and even the safety.
But I mean, apart from the connectivity part that you are providing, you are also a transport buyer, just like Siemens. And how do you work with your own transports?
Right. In Ericsson, we are committed to achieving a net zero value chain by 2040. And also like by 2025, we aim to reduce the transportation emission, both inbound and outbound, okay, by up to around like 25%. So we are taking really quite a lot of actions in here. For example, we are working very closely with our logistics service providers in order to create some kind of like, we call it green lane options. All right. Just for your reference, like this year, we have a trial using sustainable air fuel for highly utilized routes. We leverage electrified vehicles between sites and last miles. And we also do quite a lot of improvements in our supply chain resilience, like moving our production closer to our customers, which can reduce not only the need for air freight, but also improve our lead time to our customers as well.
So thank you for this first part. We now talked a little bit about how we all kind of provide solutions for different parts in the transport value chain. For us at Scania, we adopted science-based targets. We started off a little bit talking about that, where we aim to reduce our own, within our own operations, our carbon emissions by 50%. But also in the scope 3, you know, the emissions we cannot control that much when our products are in use at the customers. We actually emit more than 90% of our emissions come from that scope, and we are going to decrease that by 20% in 2025, which is much more challenging. And that is why we also have this discussion about how to kind of target the scope 3 in this. But I mean, we are not only helping each other in this, we also need a little bit of help from policymakers and the policy side, right? So now I would like to ask you a little bit about your main messages to politicians and the policymakers in order for them to help us speed up this transition. And I will start with you, Peter.
And starting with the grid part, I would say a general framework of what my thoughts are is we have to have a legislation that is adapted for the new market environment that electrification means. If I have two wishes at least, is one, if we should build an electric grid, we should be able to do that on a forecast. And that is, as we said, even if we see inductive charging now also, we still need to do a lot of building of the grids, and we to not be the one who stops the let's say development of the market. We have to be a little bit in front of the vehicles and in front of the charging solution. So we would really like to build on forecast, and also when we are building, a lot of time in this project is actually getting the correct permits for doing anything. I don't say that those permits, of course we need those permits, this is necessary and important also, but we have to speed them up, the processes for getting those permits. Looking into the more solutions part is that we do need, let's say, incentives for making this happen, to really kick off the market now. So it doesn't matter if we build tons of chargers, if the transporters can't buy, let's say, the vehicles and the other way around. So support the value chain all the way from, let's say, from grid to charger to vehicle. I think that would be something that could really make a difference.
Couldn't agree more. Mm. So I turn to you, Marcus. Now you have the chance, the wish list.
To start with, it's not only about target setting. And target setting in these days is very easy and everybody has a target. And targets are important, don't get me wrong, it's important to have reduction targets and we need that, but we need also the frames to realize that target, these targets. And that's a little bit what is the race at the moment between the grid infrastructure, the charging infrastructure, and then the application, if you want, where the manufacturers of cars, electric cars and electric trucks get in. So setting here the right frames and the right frames also coming together with a kind of intelligent subsidies or incentives, however you call that, to have the right stimulus at the right time so that we're not running into a situation like it is today in a lot of countries where probably the charging infrastructure now is getting up faster. The application, e-trucks and e-cars, is getting up fast, but we're lacking on the grid side. So that frame, that integrated thinking, that would be the part where I guess there's most need from a public side also to set the right frame, support it with the right stimulus and the right incentives, so that we have an integrative or an integration of that of these three systems in the right pace, so that not one gets ahead and the other one falls apart.
And now, Dinky, from Ericsson's point of view, your asks to decision makers and policy makers.
Yeah, I would say like both Marcus and Peter have actually talked pretty much the key points. So there's only one more thing I would like to bring up here is like for policymakers, especially if you want to, let's say, achieve success in both like efficiency and even like electrifications, I think digitalization is a very key area to look at. All right, so I will encourage them to look from all stakeholders' perspective, all right, and Towers working on a more integrated approach in their planning, in their deployments, and even like in their operations.
Well, thank you so much, all of you, for your participation in this panel. I will just try to sum it up a little bit, and we can conclude that there is no one silver bullet. We need to do several things in parallel in order to make this transition happen. With that said, we are all fully committed to combat climate change and driving the shift towards a sustainable transport system. So let's do this together. Thank you so much.
So interesting to see how all the pieces of the puzzle can come together and shape our own future. And so exciting to be part of this transition. If you want to join us in our journey, just continue to follow us here from Scania at IAA.